May I request Bhavana Shoshale to take over the session, please?
So, thank you, everyone. And we're now going to move on to the lipid session. And this is purely going to be, well, an interactive clinical case discussion on different aspects of management of dyslipidemia in individuals with diabetes. So I have with me today Dr. Muthu and Dr. Kumarvel, so I request both of you to join us up here on stage. And Dr. Muthu, all of you already know him. He's an endocrinologist here in Chennai, and Dr. Kumarvel's from Madurai. And we'll be taking over the cases and discussing them with you one by one. Done. So what we've decided to do is we're going to let the two doctors sit and relax, and I'm going to try and burn a few more calories and hopefully would not put on any post-conference weight. So we'll start looking at the cases individually, and I will direct the cases to our two panelists, and we will take them one by one. So we look at case one. We have a 55-year-old lady with type 2 diabetes, and she's come to us today for her annual visit. Her blood pressure is all right, 110 by 70. BMI is 22, which is okay again, and she has no complications and no comorbidities. She's under good control, A1C is 6.5, and no other complications, and her lipid profile tells you that the LDL is 100. So what are we going to do to this lady based on her risk category? Sorry, just a sec. What happened? Oh, the slides aren't coming up. Okay. I did not realize that. Why are we changing it? All right, so I'm going to read out the case again so that each of you can see. So this is a 55-year-old lady who's come to you for her annual visit, well-controlled type 2 diabetes, no other complications or comorbidities so far, and the only thing that you find in her reports is her LDL is 100. So what would you do for this person based on her risk category? What statin would you advise? So I'll request Dr. Muthu to take this and discuss how we would categorize the risk in this person and how we define different doses of statins and what is appropriate.
I think I'd first of all like to know how long has she had diabetes. We all know, all are aware that type 2 diabetes is a high cardiovascular risk state. But with regards to the American Heart Association, the AHA has divided statins into high intensity statin, where your high dose atorvastatin and rosuvastatin is divided, and your moderate intensity statin, where you use atorva and other statins at a lower doses. And then the least potent statins are used as simvastatin, so first generation statins, where we start at 10 milligrams of simvastatin or something like pravastatin. These statins are basically very low intensity. They reduce their LDL cholesterol levels around 20 to 30%, whereas you expect your moderate intensity statin to reduce your LDL cholesterol by 30 to 50%. And you categorize a high intensity statin where it can probably reduce it by more than 50%. So if you expect somebody's LDL cholesterol to be reduced from 160 to 80, then you want them to be on a high intensity statin. So this lady is particularly at 55. She has got type 2 diabetes. Her blood pressure is well controlled. Her BMI is surprisingly 22. She doesn't have any complications or comorbidities. What would the AHA say here is probably a moderate intensity statin would be the advisory here. With the LDL of 100, we would expect the LDL in her case to be less than 100. If potentially there are any complicating comorbid factors, which is not there, then we might be wanting to be having it less than 70. So in her case, I'd probably start around 10 milligrams of atorvastatin, or even 20 milligrams of simvastatin would be accurate for her.
Okay, perfect. So I think I would summarize that and ask you all to again just take home one message that if you think of statin and you're thinking of starting a high intensity statin, that would be 20 to 40 milligrams of rosuvastatin, whereas if one were using atorvastatin, it would be 40 to 80 milligrams of atorvastatin as a high intensity statin to reduce the LDL by more than 50%. If you want to reduce it by about 30% or so, then it would be 10 to 20 milligrams of atorvastatin or 5 to 10 mg of rosuvastatin. We don't actually use low intensity, that is doses lower than that, in anyone with type 2 diabetes because it is not recommended, because none of the studies have shown that we dose statins today based on just the LDL, and it's purely based on the risk category. And we'll come to risk categories as well in the next couple of minutes. So do we have any questions regarding this case, or Dr. Kumarveer, would you like to add anything to that case before we move on to the next one?
I think the previous case, there's a discordance between the recommendation and what we routinely practice. One thing they have made it very clear is any patients with type 2 diabetes more than 40 years of age and your LDL cholesterol more than 70, it's moderate intensity. There is no question of low intensity statin as per the guidelines. And they say the moderate intensity of statin would be 20 to 40 milligram of, at least 20 milligram of atorvastatin. But basically what happens, Asian subjects, they respond to statin better. And again, the statin effect is highly heterogeneous. So in our clinical practice, most probably, as Muthu said, we end up using at least 10 milligram of atorvastatin. That is what routinely we use for the LDL of 100. But the guidelines, they don't accept these things.
Yes, the guidelines may ask you to actually use 20 milligrams. And so would you recommend that the audience change that practice of instead of using a low dose,
again, the
moving
guidelines
to
have made it very clear
approach?
There should be at least 30% reduction in the LDL cholesterol. If suppose we are able to achieve that with this 10 milligram of atorvastatin, I think that is what, more than dose, what is important is the intensity or the degree of LDL reduction.
Yes, so I think we will end this case concluding that we would use a moderate intensity statin in this individual, and if we do not see sufficient change in the LDL at follow-up, then maybe think of intensifying the dose. So anyone over 40 years with type 2 diabetes, a statin is recommended in order to reduce cardiovascular risk. Any additions, or do we move on to case number 2?
I think
okay.
Yes.
All right. So we move on to case 2. And now we have a 50-year-old male who smokes. He has 10 years of type 2 diabetes, and he's undergone a bypass surgery in the past. His A1C is 7.1. Blood pressure is 142 over 90. He's on treatment with 5 milligrams of rosuvastatin. And the lipid profile is up there for all of you to see. Total cholesterol is 160. Triglycerides are 250. LDL is 90 and HDL is 40. So let's look at which of the options are actually correct. So we have a middle-aged man, smoker, at high cardiovascular risk because he's already had one cardiovascular event, and the LDL is 90. So that's basically the profile that you have. So which of the following is true? The LDL is acceptable because it's below 100, and then therefore we can continue the same dose of statin. So that's option one. Option two, the LDL is high, and therefore we increase the rosuvastatin dose from 5 mg to 10 mg. Option three, both LDL and triglycerides are high, so we increase the rosuvastatin also and add a fibrate. Or option four, patient has pre-existing cardiovascular disease, and therefore we need to use a high-intensity statin and increase the rosuvastatin from 5 to 20. So let's look at this case in bit. So Dr. Muthu, if you look at this case profile and look at the lipid profile, what do you think needs to come down? Is it the LDL or triglyceride, or how are we going to assess the risk in this patient?
I think this is a typical case of secondary prevention. What we are thinking about here, he's got established CVD already. He's had a bypass, coronary artery bypass grafting at a young age of 50. And he's got still uncontrolled dyslipidemia. So these are the issues, and his glycemic control is good. His blood pressure is slightly suboptimal, which needs to be managed. But here the primary problem is still an LDL. His HDL is fair in Indian circumstances. So we probably ought to control the LDL more. If you look at the American Heart Association guidelines, there's always a big, again, as Dr. Kumarvel mentioned, there is always a big divide between the guidance and what we practice. But here, this patient is just on 5 milligrams of rosuvastatin. He's had established CVD. His rosuvastatin needs to be bumped up. And with all those options there, I'd probably go with 4 to start off with. And if he tolerates it, and if the LDL comes below 70, we'll be glad. If not, probably move further.
Okay, so Dr. Kumarvel, why not target the triglyceride in this case? Do you agree with Dr. Muthu? Do we first look at the LDL and then think of triglyceride? Or at what point do you think of non-statin therapies?
No, I think in this case, I would totally agree with Muthu, because this is a case of secondary prevention, and LDL target is more than 70. So basically, everything they recommend is high-intensity statin, which should be 20 million of rosuvastatin. But I would probably, since the patient is with 5 milligram only, because they say from moderate intensity, you have to increase to high intensity. That is what the guideline says. So the moderate intensity would be 10 milligram of rosuvastatin, and the high intensity becomes 20 milligram of rosuvastatin. So in this patient, it is 5 milligram. Probably I would increase to 10 milligram initially. Then after, say, 4 to 12 weeks, if still my LDL target is not achieved, I may increase to 20 milligram. And once when I reach my LDL target, because that is when I will look at the triglyceride, because triglyceride as a primary tool, we would consider only when it is more than 500. Your fasting triglyceride more than 500, provided other secondary causes of hypertriglyceridemia are ruled out, like hypothyroidism, alcoholism, uncontrolled blood sugar, and kidney problems and other things. So in this patient, I would agree with Muthu, like I would target the LDL rather than looking at TGL.
Okay. So I think what we take home from this is when anyone comes to you and they have a pre-existing cardiovascular disease, the statin dose that needs to be given to them is a high-intensity statin, provided, of course, as Dr. Muthu pointed out, that the patient tolerates the statin. So we'll go to a case of statin intolerance in some time. So the option here would be to increase the dose of rosuvastatin from 5 to 20 milligrams. So Dr. Muthu, what would you say about stepping it up from 20 to again 40? Because the recent European Society is saying that you actually get the LDL down not to just 70, but you get it down to under 50. So is there sufficient evidence to bump it up further from 20 to 40, or are we still looking at that a little skeptical?
I think with the current evidence and the multiple guidelines, the numerous controversies, we are talking about statin therapy. Anything less than 70 would be adequate. In an Indian setting, tolerability of statin is also a big problem, where if you put them on 40 or 80 milligrams of atorvastatin for a longer period of time, it's with questionable efficacy, then it becomes a problem. So here I'd probably stick to 20 milligrams as such, and I would expect it to work. Certainly with the levels at 90, it should bring it down by around at least 30%. Whether you want to bring it down to less than 50 is a big question. The data is not there. One or two studies have pointed out, smaller studies, but the big meta-analysis haven't proven that yet. So there is no still, I would probably stick to 70 rather than 50.
Okay, so at this point of time, the ADA also does recommend that we use a high-intensity statin, and so there is sufficient evidence for us to conclude this case saying that we bump it up to 20 mg. And we hope that since the LDL is just 90 here, we expect a close to 50% or more reduction in LDL, so the patient meets the target as well. But however, if there is an individual with a family history of some lipid disturbances and familial hypercholesterolemia, then probably those would be the individuals where you might need to uptitrate from 20 to a higher dose as well. So
we'll just ask if there are any questions from the audience.
Yes, are there any questions from the audience regarding case 1 and case 2 so far? We have plenty of time open for discussion at the end, so if you have questions, we could take the questions or run through the cases and then take questions.
Because
The
Now,
that's a good question, and there has been lots of studies of using fenofibrate for secondary prevention. The data for primary prevention is not there at all in the first place. Even in secondary prevention, the data is very, very thin. So all the guidances have come back on manipulating fenofibrate as an option. And certainly, there is no good data which is convincingly reducing event rates after fenofibrate. As Dr. Kumarvel pointed out, anything more than 400 or 500, you're concerned about secondary dyslipidemia causing pancreatitis as such. But with reduction in cardiovascular mortality, there is a very, very minimal benefit, and the toxicity rates go up significantly when you use a combination, especially in people with mild to moderate renal impairment. If you combine a statin with a fibrate, the chances of getting myopathy, rhabdomyolysis, is quite high. And we do not use, for mild rises like this of 250, we do not put TGL. Yes, the patients are a lot more worried about the TGL. You need to educate them, convince them, but I don't think there is any evidence for treating TGL as such at all. Primarily, we concentrate on the LDL. If at all, if the LDL is not working for you to bring the statin is not working for you to bring the LDL down, then probably ezetimibe is another ideal situation. Currently, there is no strong evidence for fenofibrate as an option at all. If somebody is having, despite controlling all the measures for secondary dyslipidemia, as Dr. Kumarvel said, you're not able to bring it down and it's already 350, then that's when you have to put them on fibrates just for controlling your TGL, but what you get for your buck or the side effects is probably very less. Anything from 4 to 12 weeks, probably 12 weeks is a good time for a statin to stabilize and achieve an equilibrium.
So you could ask the patient to come back after a month, but up to 2 months or 3 months later as well, the lipid profile could be rechecked. So we'll move on to case three. And there's now a 45-year-old female who has come to you. She has type 2 diabetes for 10 years. Her A1C is 7.5, she's obese, so BMI is 29, and blood pressure is okay. Her non-fasting lipid profile is as follows. Total cholesterol is 190, triglycerides around 300, HDL is 45, and the LDL is 70. So what would you choose as the approach next? You initiate weight loss program because you feel there is no indication for lipid-lowering therapy in this lady. You start fenofibrate because the triglyceride is what is really striking me high there. Or you ask her to repeat a fasting lipid profile and come back because she's come to you with a non-fasting lipid profile, so maybe it's not correct. Or you say, no, it's okay, and I believe this report, and this is fine, and you start 20 milligrams of atorvastatin. So we'll address the first part, Dr. Kumarvel, of difference between a fasting and non-fasting lipid profile, and to what extent do we have to rely on a non-fasting lipid profile, and when do we really need to call the patient back in a fasting state to check this? And then we look at the risk.
Yeah. I think in lipid profile, only the triglyceride, we require fasting lipid profile. In all other things, when you're looking at total cholesterol, HDL, and when you're having a direct LDL measurement, fasting is really not required. I think now there are so many data, meta-analysis to suggest non-fasting triglyceride lipid profile is as comparable to your fasting lipid profile as far as cardiovascular risk factors are concerned. But if you are looking at triglyceride, and if you want to start therapy for hypertriglyceridemia, you need a fasting lipid profile to document what could be the triglyceride level. But this is a very interesting case in the sense, because as the guideline said, as I said, any LDL more than 70, more than or equal to 70 in a diabetic patient more than 40 years of age warrants statin therapy. So as far as first choice is concerned, there's no indication lipid-lowering therapy is wrong. You require lipid-lowering therapy in this patient. Patient BMI is 29. Initiate weight loss program is definitely there, but we would still start him on statin. Second choice, start fenofibrate to lower triglycerides. In this patient, because it's a non-fasting lipid profile, I would not really take this 310 very significant, and because it's a non-fasting state. And again, having said earlier, only when your triglycerides is more than 500 where we are concerned about pancreatitis, we would think about fenofibrate. And this patient, probably we would not start fenofibrate also. And ask her to repeat a fasting lipid profile and come back. I don't think we will bite time. That would be a clinical inertia in this patient. Because you have your LDL, you have your total cholesterol, you have your HDL, you have a patient's clinical profile. I think this patient would definitely require a statin. Though the guidelines suggest these patients would require a moderate intensity statin of 20 milligram, probably I might start on 10 milligram and then step up to 20 milligram if required.
Dr. Muthu, would you like to add anything to that? I think you summarized that perfectly.
I think there is nothing more to add.
Okay, so from the audience, anything that you would like to clarify regarding testing of lipid profile?
So the non-fasting triglycerides are definitely higher. Yeah, it would be less.
So if someone, would this report came back to you with a triglyceride of, let's say, 700, then would say, okay, I need to assess if this is accurate or not and ask for a fasting. But if it's 300, if it's a fasting lipid profile, the triglyceride value is going to be less than this. So we would not treat the triglycerides until it is crossing 500. So at this point, there's no need to call the patient back for a fasting value. Yes, sir. I think I will move to the next slide and that
yeah,
should
you
help
can go
you.
To the next question. So I think to answer your first question, I think we have next slide which gives you a very clear answer for your first question, which we are looking at a primary prevention, what has to be done. So primary prevention, what they say is you assess the atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease risk in each age group. And you can see the right side, which suggests whenever your LDL cholesterol is more than or equal to 190, irrespective of whatever it is, these patients require treatment. Second thing is that diabetic patient between age 40 to 75, you require moderate intensity statins. And diabetes patients between 40 to 75, you assess your risk assessment has to be done, then high intensity statin. And if it is more than 75, I think you have to do a clinical assessment, discuss with the patient and decide whether to take it forward or not. So in diabetic patient, what they say is you do not do a risk assessment initially. So any diabetic patient would require a statin, there's no doubt in it. So risk assessment is done in those patients who are non-diabetic, where there's a low risk. You can have a borderline risk, intermediate risk, or high risk. Based on what it is, you decide what has to be done. So in our patient, I think probably they would require treatment that becomes, definitely required. I think regarding your second question, what exactly?
So can you repeat the question again?
Yeah, non-HDL.
Non-HDL.
I'll tell you the advantage of looking at non-HDL cholesterol is because generally your teaching is that we say HDL cholesterol is a good cholesterol, LDL is bad, TGL is bad, but the whole lipid profile does not take into account other bad cholesterol like IDL, intermediate density and other things. So people feel looking at non-HDL cholesterol is more a reliable marker of all atherogenic lipid profile rather than looking at LDL alone. Because LDL are looking at different subsets of your bad cholesterol, like you're looking at LDL, you're looking at TGL, but you don't look at ID intermediate density lipoproteins are not seen. So people feel like non-HDL cholesterol is a more surrogate marker of all atherogenic lipids, but most of the guidelines are based on your LDL cholesterol.
So Dr. Muthu, what do you feel about the use of these risk engines which predict 10-year cardiovascular risk? Are these actually validated in Indians? And so is there a reason for us to use it? Or do we go by the age cutoffs and start statin in practice?
I think our answers, we look at primarily as diabetics and non-diabetics here. When you have got type 2 diabetes on board, all the risk engines doesn't matter. You just, you're a step ahead already. Your risk of cardiovascular disease is doubled to tripled on the day your diagnosis of diabetes happens. And as the number of years go by, your risk only climbs up rather than comes down. So if you compare somebody with a 5-year risk of, 5-year history of diabetes to a 15-year risk of diabetes, your risk of significant vascular disease is more common in the longer range patients. So your risk goes up as number of years go by. So having these patients on a statin becomes mandatory. So all diabetics, unless contraindicated, need a statin. Whether you're going to put them on a moderate intensity statin or a low intensity statin is the question in most of these guidelines. Generally, if you go back a few years ago, the 2013 guidelines was fairly very aggressive. They wanted to put everybody on a moderate intensity statin at a higher dose and forget measuring cholesterols at all, which underwent a lot of controversy at that time. And then people reverted back and we started measuring, the guidance was changed and people addressed measuring cholesterols and managing the numbers back again. When it comes to non-diabetics, obviously the risk, primary prevention, we are talking here about primary prevention, the risk is comparatively lower when you compare diabetics and non-diabetics. And there you, whichever risk engine you are comfortable with, you just address it and you just take, mostly we use a 10-year risk. And if the risk is higher, like greater than 7.5% or 10%, depending on what risk engine you use, then you put them on a statin. This is for non-diabetic primary prevention. Whereas diabetic, you just need to put them on a statin, whatever be the case. Maybe at a lesser dose if the numbers are lower. But primarily, the guidelines are very, very strict on this, that all diabetics needs to be on a good dose of statin, whatever it is.
So I think to summarize what both our panelists have said, we would conclude that in everyone with type 2 diabetes with age 40 to 75 years and LDL equal to or more than 70, or even irrespective of the LDL, the guidelines do advise us to start a moderate intensity statin irrespective of the 10-year cardiovascular risk. So you could calculate it, but even if you do not, it would be okay to look at the age, look at other risk factors, and start the individual on statin therapy. Do we have any questions from the audience about the previous case before we move on to the next one? Yes, it does say that, but that is persistently elevated if probably you feel that there are all other risk factors like premature ASCVD and LDL continues to be above 160 despite treatment with the highest dose of statin. So these would be at individuals at the highest risk. But in most individuals, you treat the LDL, give them a statin, and you would actually see even the triglycerides coming down. So yes, giving someone the highest dose of statin, and there's still a family history of cardiovascular disease, LDL continues to be above 160, and they have other comorbidities, it is likely that they may need other lipid-lowering therapy as well. But to what extent it would benefit and result in reduction of long-term cardiovascular events, we don't have actual data to support that. So maybe PCSK9 inhibitors would be an option, though it's not mentioned in this.
I think to answer your question, basically they are looking at whenever whatever lipid-lowering drug statins you use, there is always a residual risk which remains. You give statins, it reduces your coronary event by 30% or 35% depending on whatever study you use, still a residual risk remains. And diabetic, you give a very good glycemic control, there is some 15 to 20% reduction in macrovascular events, still a residual risk remains. So you have a group of patients, there is something called risk enhancers, where patients with CABG, with a very high risk patients, in such patient, in spite of good glycemic control, in spite of, say, maximum dose of high intensity statins, still hypertriglyceridemia is there, which is more than 175, and when you have such risk enhancers, you can consider fenofibrate. So that's the place where they say you have a role of combination therapy, and whenever you're using a combination therapy, monitoring for the side effect or adverse event of statin should be very vigilant.
If you're probably very much worried about your triglycerides, then probably if you look at the evidence, you've got high strength fish oils have got more evidence in reducing your sudden cardiac death risk compared to your fenofibrate as such. So that's one consideration you can go for if you want. See, I totally agree with you, but provided the diet lifestyle measures have been taken care of, and the glycemic control is managed, if it's mixed dyslipidemia you've got, then probably the reason why we address the statin is even with statins your triglycerides do come down. So the statins reduce triglycerides between 12 to 20%. What I do with my patients is, I'll tell you, is basically I tell them that the risk is very low. I tell them not to worry about the triglycerides. I put them on high strength fish oils, like up to 2 grams a day, and leave it as such. If it is still more than 300, then probably a fenofibrate would be a choice. But nothing, if it's persistently greater than 300, I'll consider adding fibrate, but not less than that. Yes, sir.
The risk enhancer basically, fundamentally, they include for primary prevention without diabetes. Any diabetics should take, if LDL is more than 70, should have at least moderate intensity statins, underlying statins. And again, my personal take and also the guidelines say that you should assess the risk. And if they are high risk category, you should go for high dose statins. But risk enhancers are basically for patients with low risk, intermediate risk. And if you have that, for example, 175, and triglyceride more than 175, in spite of standard therapy, then you can go for higher things. Fibrates have not been shown, but the subgroups which showed that the triglyceride more than 202 have a benefit in cardiovascular, that is subgroup analysis. It's a big study going on. So the issue is no diabetic is a low risk person. There are at least intermediate risk.
All right, thank you, sir. So we'll move on to the next case. We have a 60-year-old man with type 2 diabetes for 5 years, and he's come to you for a routine visit. He smokes and he also has peripheral arterial disease. His blood pressure is high and he's obese as well. He's currently not on treatment for hypertension, so that's something that needs to start. But we look at the lipid profile for now. He's already on a high intensity statin. He's taking 80 milligrams of atorvastatin and with aspirin as well, and compliance with medication is good. But despite that, his LDL is 110. So what do we do now, Dr. Kumar Vail? So he's on the highest dose of statin, LDL is high, and he still is at risk. So how do you approach this patient?
I think this is a type 2 diabetic patient who is on high intensity statin of 80 milligram of atorvastatin. In spite of that, LDL is 110. So these are the kind of patients where you would require non-statin therapy as add-on. So which could be STMIP or PCSK inhibitors. And I think STMIP has shown to reduce the LDL cholesterol at least by 20% in such kind of patients. So probably I would continue the same dose of atorvastatin and add STMIP for this patient.
Okay, so most people, when we see them come back, the normal question they ask us is, I think this medicine is not working, why don't you change to a different one? So let's be very clear that changing atorvastatin to rosuvastatin when the patient's already on the highest dose may not actually make any difference. So we continue the statin as it is, and as we discussed, we would then consider a non-statin therapy in addition as well. Dr. Muthu, would you like to add something to that?
just playing devil's advocate here, basically the only thing about the difference between atorva and rosuvastatin is the tolerability of the higher strength doses is pretty good with rosuvastatin when compared to atorvastatin, especially with the safety of liver function profiles and things like that. And the tolerability of the patient with muscle pains and cramps are much, much better off with rosuvastatin at 40 milligrams when compared to 80 milligrams of rosuvastatin. So
I think another point that we brought out now is tolerability of the statin. So if an individual is tolerating a particular statin at the highest dose, it would be absolutely okay to continue it. However, if someone does have symptoms of myalgia, pains, and you don't really know why it is, a differential diagnosis that one could consider is statin intolerance. And at that point, many a time, switching to a different statin can make the symptoms go away. So that is definitely something that we would consider if the patient comes back with myalgias. So I think we discussed classification. So to summarize, I would add that in all adults 40 to 75 years with type 2 with diabetes, regardless of the 10-year risk, a moderate intensity statin is indicated. If someone has multiple CV risk factors, a high intensity statin may also be necessary. And with someone with more than 20% ASCVD risk, and at the highest dose of statin therapy, if the LDL is still high, then we would consider adding non-statin therapies as well. So we move on to the last case. The fourth case. So the last case, where a 55-year-old man presents for routine evaluation and has diabetes and dyslipidemia. He started on metformin and 20 milligrams of atorvastatin. Comes back to you, LDL is 80, but the patient now has muscle ache. So this is typically the kind of patient that Dr. Muthu was telling us about, that you start one statin and the patient complains to you with that he has some side effects. So what would we do now for an individual who comes like this, presents like this? So do we stop the statin completely, or do we change to a different statin? Do we reduce the dose, or do we look for other causes of muscle pain?
I think with muscle aches with statin, we try to evaluate them. First of all, if it's a simple muscle ache or a strain, then you need to exclude that first of all. If it's a typical muscle ache related to a statin, mostly these are typical cramps which occur during any time of the day, or including worse at night. And these are mostly happens at your hamstrings or your calf muscles, and the patients typically complain of them. As the dose increases, generally it increases with your dosage. Predominantly what we do in the first case is, if at all they are in a very high dose, probably cut it back and see if they tolerate it. The other thing what you can probably advise these patients is giving them coenzyme Q10, which is an antioxidant which can help statin-induced muscle aches. So the dose is probably anywhere around 100 milligrams once a day to twice a day will help with the addition. So that can help. If they don't respond at the state, then probably you need to give a drug holiday for at least a few months or so. So that's probably what would be the first step. Obviously, if it's very severe and it's all over, then probably thinking about measuring CPK is probably mandatory with the liver function abnormality as well.
Yes, so anyone who is unable to continue a statin because of a side effect, the first thing that we would do is stop the statin to see if the symptoms go away, and then measure markers of liver function and muscle. So you could check the LFT and the creatinine kinase to see if it is abnormal. Not that most patients would have biochemical abnormalities, but they may just have symptoms. And if it is due to statin intolerance, the symptom would go away. You could re-challenge the statin as well and see if the symptoms come back. And that is something that the patient should agree to do, because some of them may not want to take it again. Most of the time, the presentation is actually mild, and myositis or rises in creatinine kinase may not be very, very common, but it is certainly something to consider. So rule out other causes that could cause myalgia, reduce the dose of the statin, so if someone's on a higher dose, reduce the dose, or even change to a different statin, that may help. Some individuals may not have any symptoms if they take the dose every alternate day, so some of them may prefer to do that. If nothing works, give a drug holiday and then rechallenge with a lower dose. At the end, if none of the options are okay, you could try non-statin therapies, but we don't really know to what extent it may benefit this individual. So I will ask our panelists to take the questions and continue the discussion. Okay. All right, so how long should we give statins, and do we need to stop statins once the patient's LDL target is reached? So I'll request Dr. Kumar Vail to take that. Hmm? Okay, and that's the last question, so we will stop there.
I think.
Okay, fine. So we'll take all the questions.
I think the main aim of giving statin is not only to reduce the LDL cholesterol, but to prevent the cardiovascular risk factors. So probably LDL cholesterol might happen earlier, but this block stabilization, other thing might take a longer time. So I think we should not stop statins in, as long as the patient is tolerating statins.
Okay, so.
So it's a lifelong therapy.
It's lifelong therapy. So we'll be very clear that we're not giving statin to reduce LDL. Reduce cardiovascular risk, so it's lifelong. So one of someone in our audience is asking us if we have a patient who is obese, but all the metabolic parameters that we see are actually normal, BMI of 35 and age under 40, should we still start a statin? So.
I think if, what did you say the cholesterol was?
Cholesterol is normal. Metabolically, all parameters are normal, but the BMI is 35, and the patient is also under 40 years of age.
Here, the argument for lifestyle modification is the first choice. If there are no metabolic parameters telling us that there is any secondary causes of the by metabolically normal, what we mean is there is no secondary causes for the obesity. So, if there are no secondary causes of obesity, then we put on the obesity to lifestyle. So probably addressing the lifestyle, she's only 35 years.
No, age is under 40, but BMI is 35.
Yeah, so age under 40, yes. primarily lifestyle modification. I don't think role for statin is here. I think we need to modify her diet and exercise pattern.
Okay, so I think I would maybe try that, but if the weight is not coming down, because I would want Indians to be at a BMI under 23, so 35 to 23 is long way off, so... I would want to start a statin therapy, but that's something you could discuss with your patient and see if they are.
I would prefer to start the therapy to reduce her weight rather than targeting statin for this.
Of course, they have to lose weight. You have a question? Yes?
So maybe this is the kind of person where I would use another risk factor quantification, like a coronary artery calcium score. If this person has a score of zero, then you know he's free for 5 years. But this is someone I would do a risk factor stratification. I mean, I'm just trying to go from the cardiologist and not the endocrinologist perspective. But Dr. Uman, maybe you want to add on to this. Just this is both answers are right, but I'm just giving you a different perspective.
Absolutely. So you look at those risk enhancers, and one of them is called coronary artery calcium. And if it's more than 100, definitely I would put. Now even between 1 to 99, I would look for other things, including high-sensitivity troponin, maybe hsCRP. So you look at the patient as a whole. So a person who is 35 or less than 40 with a BMI has got certain amount of risk factors. Blindly, if I say, it will be somewhere around 4 to 5% or 3%. But if you add a risk enhancer, especially coronary artery calcium or biomarkers of injury or other, because if you see metabolic syndrome is there as a risk enhancer. So look at the patient holistically, and statins specifically, the calcium coronary artery calcium score is more than 100, definitely yes, 1 to 99 maybe.
Okay, so do we have time for one more question? All right, so if there are, I think there are two more questions, but we could take it outside, and those of you who ask the questions could come and talk to our panelists. So thank you all very much. And I thank Dr. Muthu and Dr. Kumar Vail as well. Thank you.